find a link for it on the Facebook page. Can I also remind you again, please, about our Lent appeal. Do please help us if you can. Our needs are very great, both for charitable purposes and also just for paying our way. We don't own our premises here, we have to rent it. And that is a considerable drain on our resources. If you can help us, please, we'd be eternally grateful. Now, if you're able, please, as you stand, we will sing our entrance hymn, "For me who seek a comfort shore in trouble and distress." Forever and ever. Amen.
when Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you, throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, as for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her Sarah, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. As our response to that reading, let us say together the latter part of Psalm 22, which you'll find on the reverse side of the page. Praise the Lord, you that fear him. Stand before him, O offspring of Israel. For you of Jacob's line, give him glory. For he does not despise or abhor the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. When they cry to him, he hears. My praises of him in the greatest assembly. I will perform my vows in the presence of those who worship him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. And those who seek the Lord shall praise him. May your heart live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nation shall bow before him. For kingship belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations. To him alone, all who sleep in the earth bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust fall before him. My soul shall live for him. My descendants shall serve him. They shall be known as the Lord's forever. They shall come and make known to the people yet more the saving deeds that he has done.
The second reading today is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 4, verses 13 to 25. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherence of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the inheritance of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of us all, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said. So numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. In other words, it was reckoned to him, were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Glory and praise to you, O Christ. If any wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Glory and praise to you, O Christ. The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great sufferings and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd of his disciples and said to them, "If any wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. May I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed Peter, author of Scripture, first pope, chief apostle, teacher and defender of the faith, pillar of the early church, purported benefactor of the Gospel of Mark, and martyr. It reads like a who's who entry, doesn't it? It is little wonder that St. Peter gets so much good press amongst Christians. But yet there is one thing missing from this list. One thing, in fact, that is among the blessed apostles' greatest gifts. Peter had that unique ability to find precisely the wrong moment to say the wrong thing. Or, to put it another way, Peter was an expert opening his mouth and putting his foot in it. All too often, just so like us. Listen to it again. Then Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all of this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Now, at first, we might be tempted to think that Peter simply forgot himself, that he got so caught up in the thought of Jesus' death that he spoke out of turn. But if we were to go back just 2 verses before the beginning of today's Gospel reading, to verse 29, we would hear Peter answer Jesus' question, "Who do you say that I am?" With certainty and affirmation, "You are the Messiah." And so, seemingly, without giving it a second thought, Peter professes that Jesus is the Messiah 1 minute, and then scolds him like an irresponsible teenager the next. One might well imagine that the other disciples watched this scene unfold anxiously, if not a little incredulously, as children watching their brother or sister arguing with their parents at the dinner table. But yet, it's what happens after all this that is truly shocking. Jesus says, "If any wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it." That's the moment that Peter and the disciples realized that the God they wanted was not the God made known in Jesus Christ. The disciples wanted a God who would be a savvy, political, and military leader, leading the charge to put the Romans in their place once and for all. They wanted someone who would raise them up to a position of power and importance. And they wanted someone so radical that their enemies would cower and flee. They were convinced that the keys to a good life lay in strength and power. Instead, they got someone who taught about loving others, feeding the hungry, and foretold his own impending death at the hands of the very same powers he was supposed to overcome. This was indeed not what they had signed up for. Bearing this in mind, it is a bit easier then to understand why Peter was so upset. If we had been standing where he and the other disciples were standing, we might have been upset too. But then again, who among us hasn't wanted a God who just swoops down at the first sign of trouble and sets things right? We ask God for a good parking spot. We pray for winning lottery numbers. We long for the phone call with the news of a better job or the approval from the bank for the new car or the bigger house. Because in one way or another, we believe that if we can get just a little bit ahead and become just a little more successful, or if we could amass just a little bit more clout or influence, our lives would be much better. The disciples weren't the only ones who believed that the keys to a good life were strength and power. More often than not, we believe it too. But this attitude about God also shows up in places that aren't so self-serving. When tragedy strikes, we pray and pray and pray for a different outcome. And yet God seems far away from us. Those of us who have been at the bedside of a friend or a family member who died much too soon often find ourselves staring into the cold, dark silence of death, feeling abandoned by God. Coming to grips with the end of a long relationship with a lover or a friend causes us, possibly, to doubt this God whom we worship. Why doesn't God just fix all this, we wonder? If God loves us so very much, then why do we suffer so terribly? But as Mark's Gospel reminds us, if we are to confess Jesus as Messiah, we must do so by standing at the foot of the cross as he is crucified. The God we worship is about more than simply fixing our lives. The God we worship is about laying down his life for the sake of our own. So the moment we allow this truth to penetrate deep into our souls is the same instant we realize that the suffering we see around us, in the hospital bed, in the prison, on the street, or in the mirror, is none other than the crucified Christ laying down his life again and again in the midst of our suffering. If any wants to become my followers, Jesus said, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Taking up our cross means recognizing Christ crucified in the suffering world around us, and then recalling that true discipleship is paved by the way of our own cross. But walking in the way of the cross and proclaiming Christ crucified isn't the end of the story. No, it's just the beginning. The story continues on through the resurrection of Easter, and even to this day, this very moment. However, we cannot know the fullness of Christ's resurrection unless we are first willing to know Christ crucified. The great 50 days of Easter find their meaning only after the solemn 40 days of Lent. Easter morning finds its consummation only through Good Friday. Put quite simply, we can't have the crown without the cross. And so, as we continue our journey through this holy season of Lent, may we walk alongside one another, bearing our crosses and proclaiming the faith of Christ crucified, the faith of militant love, of subversive grace, and radical mercy. And may our hearts be filled with the sure and certain hope of the resurrection. Amen. Let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the church and for the world.
We pray to the Lord for courage to give up other things and to give ourselves to him this Lent. Give your church the courage to give up her preoccupation with herself and to give more time to your mission in the world. We pray for the welfare of your church here on earth, guided and governed by your Spirit, so that all Christians may be led in the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. May the blood and water flowing from the side of Jesus bring forgiveness to your people and help us to face the cost of proclaiming salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give your world the courage to give up war, bitterness, and hatred, and to seek peace. We pray for the leaders of all the nations of this world, and especially for the king and government of Thailand, and also in the countries from which we come. We remember for the people of Myanmar, India, which is seeing a surge in its COVID-19 cases, the United States of America, and those in the Russian Federation. Give wisdom to those in authority in every land, and give to all people a desire for righteousness and peace, the will to work together in trust, to seek the common good, and to share with justice and equity the limited resources of the earth. May the shoulders of the risen Jesus, once scourged by the soldiers, bear the burden of political and military conflict in our world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us the courage to give up quarrels, strife, and jealousy in our families, neighborhoods, and communities. We pray for all who are prevented from or persecuted for practicing their faith, especially for Christians in North Korea, China, Pakistan, Iran, Sudan, and Nigeria. We pray for our fellow Christians both here in Thailand and also in our own home countries. We ask your blessing on Cephalod, our bishop, on this, our parish of St. George, for its work, its worship, and its witness. We pray particularly for Father David in his ministry to us and for all members of our congregation, be they near or far. May the presence of the risen Jesus, his body once broken and now made whole, bring peace and direction as we live with one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us the courage to give up our selfishness as we live for others, and to give time, care, and comfort to the sick. We pray for those who suffer, the sick, the poor, the depressed, the lonely, the unloved, the persecuted, the unemployed, those who grieve, and those who care for them. And we remember all those whose lives have been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. We pray for all those who live in our parish of Pattaya, who have been adversely affected by the pandemic, so many of whom depend on the hotel and hospitality industry. Amongst the sick, we remember Father Tom, Robert, Colin, Andy, Mavis, Patricia, Peter, Eric, Kent, and any others known personally to each and every one of us. Give them a trust in your goodness and help those who minister to them. May the wounded hands of Jesus bring his healing touch and the light of his presence fill their rooms. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us the courage to give up our fear of death and to rejoice with those who have died in faith. We pray for all who have died in the hope of the resurrection and for all the departed that we name at this time. Michael, Paul, Kunbas, and Jackie, who have died recently, and for those whose anniversary falls at this time, known personally to each and every one of us, that your will for them may be fulfilled. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. May the feet of the risen Lord Jesus, once nailed to the cross, walk alongside the dying and bereaved in their agony, and walk with us and all your church through death to the gate of glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, who has promised to hear our prayer, grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting them to the Lord's table. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Mighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us stand for the greeting of peace. Christ is our He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace in the traditional time with a word. Sing our offertory hymn, "Take up thy cross," the Saviour said, "if thou wouldst my disciple be." Biscuit prayer C on page 19. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We will lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son Jesus Christ, your living Word. Through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Savior. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh was your son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And now we give you thanks because he was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night as he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial. Our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Saint George and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Pray with confidence to the Father, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, ever and ever. Amen. O Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us peace. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. This is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Let us pray. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us to life. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live for Jesus' life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit guides invite to the world. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness. Deny yourselves, take up your cross, and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you all for being with us this afternoon. We should be here again next Sunday, and we hope to have your company as well. Let us bring our celebration of the Eucharist to a conclusion by standing to sing our recessional hymn, There's a Wideness in God's Mercy, Like the Wideness of the Sea.
Thanks be to God. The souls of the faithful, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.